All right. So today we are talking about Haruhi Suzumiya, the melancholy thereof.
Oh, yes.
And this is episode 10, broadcast order, a.k.a. the melancholy of Haruhi Suzumiya, episode 4, in terms of episode title. So that's what you got. That's what we're doing there. Hey, Liquid, glad you could join us.
Howdy.
As always. So this episode is, if you're watching this in chronological order, this is probably the first shocker of the show, where we've seen weirdness up until this point, but pretty normal weirdness, if you will. People have been claiming things, and there's been some strangeness. And this is where Haruhi starts getting, well, this is where the show starts living up to his name, because what is Haruhi right now? She's actually melancholy.
She is.
Kind of frustrated because, well, why is she frustrated? She's kind of annoyed because, gosh, nothing strange has been happening.
It's too normal. It's
way too normal.
Too normal.
She wants something strange to happen. Well, she's gonna get her wish, isn't she?
Yeah.
So this is an episode where we finally see something interesting happen again in kind of chronological order, starting with Ryoko, who comes over and starts. She's obviously a little concerned about Haruhi. One hint that this is an unusual episode is the fact that we have no opening credit sequence. The credits are shown over the episode. And we
fit more episode in that way.
Exactly. Yeah, they have a lot to get across here, and so they're going to do that. And so in this episode, we get a bit of a surprise from Kyon, which is a letter in his
shoebox.
Yeah.
At school. So everybody has their place where they take off their shoes and swap into, I guess,
school shoes.
School shoes. It makes it easier to clean, I suppose. You don't drag in all the grit from the road.
Yeah. In fact, later in the episode, we see somebody's shoes, and we note that the character's name is written on the back of the shoes. It's an easy way to keep track of whose is whose.
But that's like the equivalent of the locker.
It is, yes. Well,
you want to leave somebody a note.
Yeah.
Where they'll get it.
Exactly.
They're going to put their foot in their shoe sooner or later.
Right.
They can't avoid that note, can they?
Yeah, and they'll open that at least twice a day. So that's an advantage. Now, the obvious and most common use of this, at least in terms of anime plots, these little romantic letters.
Love letter.
So Ryoko has surprisingly...
Not that love letter. That love letter.
So Ryoko has left a letter in Kyon's shoebox asking to meet him after school, which is something of a surprise.
Well, that's unusual.
Yeah. So Kyon goes to the club room as usual, but nothing really is happening. Haruhi comes in her little fit. She's kind of frustrated, and she's playing around on the computer. We have this wonderful little scene where Kyon is just idly watching her and looking at the website and noticing all of these photos of Mikuru on the website in the maid uniform. And he kind of freaks out a little bit.
What are you doing?
Yeah.
Look, I'm posting all these pictures on our website. We're going to get thousands of hits.
Yeah. And,
not exactly ethical.
No. And what's interesting about this little sequence is that Kyon doesn't even try to explain.
He doesn't even try.
He just walks over to the computer. No. Haruhi's going on. He just starts taking care of the pictures.
But it's funny. He gets ready to delete them, but at the last minute, he redirects that file to some other location.
Mm-hmm. It would be a waste.
It would be a waste. You don't want to get rid of them. You just don't want them posted on the website. They're still good photos.
For those watching the video, I love this expression on Haruhi as he says this kind of not sure if serious kind of expression. She's kind of evaluating, but then finally she decides, oh, fine, whatever. And he manages to kind of undelete them. And so Haruhi stands up and says, I'm leaving.
Yeah.
And off she goes. So Haruhi's in quite a state.
Yeah, not enough excitement.
Yeah, she's really peaked. In fact, she goes out and bumps into Mikuru and just keeps on walking. Really peeved.
Wow.
Kyon is actually kind of not unhappy with this, though. It makes things a lot easier.
hey, I'm here. No, yep. I'm not. I'm not going to be here today.
So easy.
But
it allows Kyon to go over to the room and find Ryoko. Now, I should mention that the note originally was just meet me in this room. It didn't say it was from Ryoko, so I'm kind of getting ahead of myself there. But Ryoko's in the room. And a few things to note here. First is the coloring.
It's very amber, like the sun is setting almost.
Exactly.
Late in the day.
Very late in the day. Now, obviously, school students who are staying late for a club are going to stay a little bit longer than normal. And so the implication here is that they've stayed long enough for it to be kind of that golden hour.
Yes, as the sun is setting.
Yeah.
As opposed to the when it comes up, it's more of a bluish hue, the evening reddish yellow.
Exactly. But the deeper point here is that it creates an otherworldly sense.
It's very mystical.
Very mystical. It's almost like we're in a different plane of existence with this beautiful light. And I do want to point out how beautifully they have that gradient from kind of orange to red to black throughout the room. It is very well done. But then Ryoko starts talking, and it very quickly starts getting kind of weird.
Yeah. What?
So what did you think about Ryoko's conversation here as she started?
I wasn't quite clear on what did she say? She she said
well, she starts talking about change. Yeah. And how do you make things change? If you see a situation that isn't changing, isn't it better to at least do something to make it move
forward?
It
seemed like she had something on her mind, but yeah, she wasn't going to come out and say it.
And the classic thing we'd all kind of assume here, if we've seen a lot of anime or read a lot of manga, is that it's some kind of
romantic.
Yes.
Yeah.
And maybe it's about somebody else. Maybe it's about somebody that she likes, that she knows he knows, and she wants to kind of get a sense about that. It could be about him. I mean, it would make sense to meet up with somebody, you know, in a classroom after school.
Uh-oh.
We've certainly seen this in series like His and Her Circumstances. This is a very similar kind of scene.
Everybody else has gone home. They have alone time.
Yeah. No janitors wandering around.
Magical hour.
Yeah.
Oh.
So then she starts saying things like, my superiors don't know what it's like out in the field.
Out in the field? Oh.
Which is quite an odd thing to say. And so she they have this sort of rapprochement where they talk back and forth about how Kyon. And Kyon is very much playing it light here. He's not agreeing, not disagreeing. He's saying, yeah, I guess, you know, you should move things forward if you feel like they should. But he's really noncommittal.
Yeah.
And then she says, well, that's great, because now I'm going to kill you.
Yeah. I'm going to kill you and see how Haruhi handles it.
Yeah. And that's an interesting.
What? What? You're not serious, are you? You're going to kill me?
Right. That's kind of a shocker. I should also note, we even see behind him a shot of a clock. So we know it's about 6:10 in the evening, which, yeah, pretty late. It's a couple hours into the day. And so he's kind of shocked, whereupon Ryoko quite literally just, you know, pulls a knife and attacks him with this wonderful, weird camera angle to it.
Initially, he says, you know, put away that rubber knife or whatever.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, she's serious. That's real. Real enough, anyway.
Yeah, and it's a great reminder about how darn safe Japanese schools are. You know, the idea of somebody's actually carrying a knife, or much less a gun, is just wouldn't even occur to you.
Yeah.
It's got to be a prop or something. But no, I mean, she's clearly quite serious about this.
As he realizes, wait.
Yeah, this is not good. And so he tries to run out the conveniently open door.
Protect yourself. Grab
Protect
a chair.
Yourself. Right, but that doesn't really work so far. Work so well.
Yeah, you can't flee.
No, she's closed it down.
And so you got to fight.
And we've seen imagery like this before, haven't we?
The flight or fight situation?
Well, not just that. I mean, literally the imagery of the room. When he tries to run away, we get these symbols all over the place.
Yeah, he's not in the spot where he's not in Kansas anymore.
No, where have we seen that before?
Now, it seems to me that when they were in that other dimension in the fella's room who they went to,
mm-hmm,
they had that same sort of experience.
Yeah, they sure did. And And who was the one kind of running the show back then? It was Yuki.
Yeah, I suspect she might have something to do with this. It's that same sort of digital pattern of this is a holodeck type of feel.
Exactly. And this becomes increasingly clear as Ryoko refers to herself as another android, another entity brought here by the Data Thought entity.
Yes.
And who's doing very similar things.
And her realm of data is all powerful in this area.
Yeah.
That's why he can't escape.
Yep. She's locked it down.
He tries to throw a chair.
Nope.
No effect.
I love that little reaction. He goes, so he is completely stopped in here. We get this very interesting framing too in this sequence where we have all this rubble sitting around and they deliberately block part of the shot with the rubble. So you're only seeing some part of the character's face. You're only seeing some part of the character's shot. And it's there to add another otherworldly layer onto what's going on. This sense that things are...
they're not in school anymore.
Not only they're not in school anymore, you know, Ryoko is now not just a normal person. And so she goes to attack him and a crack appears.
Help!
Yeah. So wow, that really hurt. Wait, I'm still alive. That's good.
Why am I still alive?
Yeah. Because Yuki has arrived and literally grabbed the blade with her hand. Which is
bleeding now.
Yeah.
All over the blade.
That's quite the shot. I just want to really emphasize.
That's not digital blood, is it? That's blood.
That's her blood. And she's explaining that Ryoko's data is damaged.
You are my backup.
Yes. Ryoko is meant to be a backup unit for Yuki. And apparently this isn't working out so well. So this is our first hint about where this shot is going. The fact that Yuki is intervening and that she is willing to hurt herself to move forward. That is almost not even in her mind, the question of whether that is a concern or not. And it is kind of a shocking thing.
As the Matrix glitches in the background.
Well, thank you for bringing that up. It's kind of interesting because we had this very solid representation of the classroom, even though it was broken, it was very solid. As soon as Yuki comes in, it starts to flicker.
It's the data background.
Yeah. And so Yuki is clearly damaging this environment in some way. And we even see the colors change as we change perspective.
The world's creation is now in contention.
Absolutely.
Who controls this?
And in fact, the knife starts to disappear.
Dissolved.
Yeah.
This data is being deleted.
Yep. But Ryoko...
But the fight goes on.
Yeah, and Ryoko is very relaxed about this. It's actually kind of fun how...
Get behind me.
you just throws him to the ground. And so there's that shot where there's her... her shoe, and I wonder if the implication here, you know, because we see her shoe with her name written on it, you know, the implication here is that Yuki didn't leave a note for Kyon. Ryoko actually left a note in that shoe.
Sneaky.
Yeah, to kind of to move forward. You know, Yuki could have done something, but she's not very deliberately. But now she's forced to do something. Now she actually has to intervene, and Ryoko maintains her cheerful self.
Wow, that was a quick...
So Yuki is sending orders back to the Data Thought entity to try to resolve this. And we see this interesting moment where Ryoko is flipping back and forth. I think this is actually something, a hint for a little later. Yuki is trying to get Ryoko deleted. Mm-hmm. And Ryoko starts walking forward and she literally like teleports as she's walking forward. I don't think that's Ryoko doing it. I don't think Ryoko is intentionally doing it. I think that's an attempt to delete her.
Ah.
And it hasn't happened yet, but she is starting to be affected.
Not a complete delete, just partial bits.
Yeah.
Bits being erased here and there.
Yuki then throws Kyon off to one side so that Ryoko will not attack him directly. But of course, she still does.
And now Yuki's torn between attack and defend.
Exactly, which is very difficult. And so she is slammed by all of these spikes. And this is a very difficult image.
Glasses.
Yeah, broken glasses.
Whoa.
There are like eight spikes.
And she's speared inside and out through every which direction.
No change in expression still. But we also do note something in the background. the background's changing even further. It used to be just these sort of weird moiré patterns, and now it's these sort of moving circular images.
Yeah, for somebody who's been shish kebabbed like yeah. that. she's pretty calm.
She's very calm. She pulls it out. I love how not only does she reach in and start to pull out one of the spikes, you see a blood spurt as it comes out. There's a pfft, as it's very disturbing. And I do love the juxtaposition there that you know, we are reminded that Yuki is not a normal person.
Yeah.
But Ryoko says, but you're so far damaged now, you know, your mobility is limited. You're not going to be able to do anything. And so she's ready to go. She cuts Yuki again. The blood spurts even onto Kyon. Yuki says, it's over. But of course, what she means is...
it's over for who?
Yeah, exactly.
As the data gets rewritten.
Yep. She finally had enough time for the message to go through. Ryoko is finally surprised for once. And all of her data starts to disappear.
Now, as a backup, that's worrisome.
Yes.
My backup is being deleted.
Although Ryoko immediately says that there are other
backups.
Mm-hmm.
And they may one day get their own volition to take control.
Yeah. If one backup could do it, others could. And we have this really very touching moment with Ryoko, where she suddenly revealed herself to be more or less a villain. And now we see that the price of her villainy is death.
Deletion.
She's being destroyed.
Completely wiped out.
Yep. And so she starts to dissolve away. And I do want to point out the how impressive it is. I mean, that animation of slowly dissolving away
all those sprite. little tiny pieces.
Yeah, and obviously you can do a certain amount of, I mean, that's all particle stuff, but to do that and then erase it slowly up the drawing takes quite a bit of effort and work. And so Ryoko basically says, enjoy your time with Haruhi, and off she goes. And Yuki collapses.
So like, accepting.
Yes. Yuki still with a blood-stained uniform.
I can't get up yet.
Yeah, exactly.
Damaged.
Whereupon the...
She rebuilds everything.
Yeah. Everything completely rebuilt.
The classroom is back.
Completely unchained.
But she's still...
She needs some time.
Yeah.
And then we get this very cute moment when she gets back up and needs a moment to help herself. And she realizes something. And this is kind of the one time we've seen her... Where she has wide eyes for a second there, and I just kind of want to rewind to point that out. Where she again, she kind of needs to get back up, and she
forgot her glasses.
She forgot to redo the glasses. And Kyon says, "Well, I think you look cuter without them." Which yeah. I personally
not agree. That I have a glasses fetish. What's a fetish?
What's a glasses fetish? You may know fetish, what a fetish yeah. is. Never mind. And then we get one of the great comedic moments in the series when Taniguchi walks in because he's forgotten his bag. He sees him
in a compromising position and he draws his own conclusions.
As I think is not unreasonable.
That time of day, closed classroom. What are they doing on the floor, cradling each other so closely? Carry on! I forget I was here.
Enjoy yourself. That was a legendary bit of voice acting in the Japanese dub. Just the way he managed the twist of the voice. This in Japanese was fantastic. So the fact that he managed to get it right in the English dub was wonderful. So Ryoko, of course, quote unquote, transfers suddenly out of the school.
Well, that's a mystery.
Yes. Yay! And so
Haruhi finally has a mystery.
And boy, is she happy.
She left with what? How mysterious.
I love the unadulterated joy on Haruhi's face at this. And then you have, of course, the series fundamental twist. This is what Haruhi wants, but what Haruhi cannot have.
Yes.
And this is if Kyon could only explain to her, but no, he's not going to do that. It's like that's how it is.
Yeah, yesterday I was almost killed And the person who I almost killed was deleted.
Yeah.
So by was.
But he receives what? Another letter.
Another letter.
And this one's signed by Mikuru. Now, here's a little bit of a hint. We see the paper and we see the writing and we notice how neat it is.
Yeah.
Very, very well written on cute little stationery. So Kion goes over, very excited, trying not to get too worked up, but he's sure this is Mikuru. He's sure it's not another trick. He's sure that's what's going on. She's exactly this kind of person. It's really an adorable scene on Kion's part. And he opens the door. When he figures, of course, Yuki's going to be there. Opens the door, and who is it? It's Mikuru? Kinda? Sorta?
Maybe her older sister? She's looking more mature.
Much older, much more mature.
Much more, wow.
Yeah. And I love how they handle this scene, where Mikuru is very familiar with Kion. It is exactly how somebody you've known for a while.
Pick up right where she left off.
Yep, absolutely. And then he doesn't believe it. And so she proceeds to...
I need some...
And so she just
unbuttons
her
top. I can prove it to you. Take a look at this. You see this right here? See this little star-shaped mole?
I should also point out another kind of hint that Mikuru has changed a little bit. She ain't wearing no bra.
No.
Which I don't think the current Mikuru would ever,
she'd never,
ever do.
Yeah, she's too modest at her current stage.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so she shows off this mole-shaped bra. And, this star-shaped mole.
Star-shaped mole.
And here's where you have an interesting thing between broadcast and chronological.
Oh.
Broadcast order, we've seen this mole before. Because we saw it, I believe, in the Murder Mystery Mansion thing.
Hmm.
This does show up later on. If you're watching it chronologically, you haven't seen this mole before. So you're thinking, is it really her, or is this just something they're throwing at us? As we get a little bit of Gynax bounce there. And of course, Crispin Freeman's famous line, where the original line was basically, "I'm shocked." And he said, "Oh, we can do better than that." So when she does that to him, he goes, "Supersize me." It's pretty appropriate. So and now we get our first real bit of lunch. Oh, and of course Mikuru.
Oh,
I love this.
You don't know about that yet.
And here again is our hint. This is the Mikuru we all know and love.
Yes.
She's made another mistake. And that's the point at which Kion kind of, okay, all right, I got it.
Yeah, it's you.
So, and yes, Kaiser, this is broadcast live. We're not live, tape on live as last week. So, yeah.
I'm right here right now.
Yes, exactly. So, yeah, so we have this wonderful scene between the two of them when we discover that she came back to give us a little warning. And it's a little bit like, so for you Doctor Who fans.
Warning from the future.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a bad wolf moment.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's
where she says, Snow White. You know, Snow White.
What could that possibly mean?
Right. But you can't say anything. That's a secret. That's classified.
Tell me more. Classified. Tell me more. How old are you?
I love that. Yeah. Yeah. And of course, you don't ask a girl her age.
Yeah.
And so she explains, no, that's classified. I also really appreciate two things here. One is Mikuru's nostalgia for the room. She walks around and says, "I couldn't possibly fit into this anymore.
Wow, I used to wear these."
And it's that sense of appreciating what it is, despite all the things she went through. I mean, of all the characters, she would be the least likely to appreciate it, but she does look back on it with nostalgia.
Now she's not even wearing a bra.
Yeah, exactly. Oh my gosh. And then also the voice acting in here, the fact that
I was hoping at that point she would kiss him.
Me too.
She was going for it. She had her lips fucking.
Yeah.
She just went around for the hug.
And here's the thing. Because here's the thing, which is very interesting, because she then says, I just ask one thing of you. Don't get too close to me. Ooh, that's a tough one.
What's that mean?
And I mean, who knows what that means? I mean, where are things going? It's very tough at this point to understand that.
But he's the one who points out to her that she had the star-shaped bowl. She didn't even know it. So there's no way he can't get closer to her.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and I also love the voice acting in here, how the voice actors on both lines, on both sides, are able to slightly more mature their voices without sounding like completely different characters. Mm. So we're left with more mysteries, more questions.
Mysteries abound.
Yeah. Yuki comes back in, and here we get another bit of a plot bombshell. As Yuki comes back in, and Kyona asks, "Have you seen someone?" And Yuki says, "Oh yeah, that's the older Mikuru." Kind of walks right in.
Yeah.
So they know about each other, which goes back to what we were saying earlier in the early episodes, when Mikuru first walks into the club room, and she sees Yuki there. She has a little bit of a moment, a little bit of a moment of surprise and recognition when she first sees them. So these two are aware of each other on some level somewhere.
And he asks about time travel.
Yeah.
No.
She says, it can't
your
be explained.
Won't work. You wouldn't understand
any. and so Haruhi is offended that Kyon isn't as interested as she is.
There's a mystery. This girl disappeared. There's no forwarding address. The teachers know nothing. There's no.
And I love that idea. We were talking about this before. You know, the idea that Haruhi would stalk up to the teachers and demand to know all about this student.
I gotta know.
Right. And that, you know, she expects that they're going to give her all the information they have. No. Not going
to
happen that way.
No one moves to Canada without saying anything.
Actually,
I guess some people do.
and that's the other thing is that, you know, this does happen for often personal and delicate reasons.
Oh.
And so, no, the teachers
they're not going to tell you.
So, yeah, they're probably not going to reveal everything. But Haruhi proceeds to drag.
Literally drag. Kyon
off and says, come on, you. Consider yourself an SOS Brigade member. She leaves a note saying, today's SOS Brigade, as you please. So it's sort of a free day.
They're on a mission, I suppose, the two of them. Hey, yep. You guys could do anything. We're going to that apartment.
We're going to find out where she is. And this is, again, kind of that that foreshadowing, this idea that now suddenly things are getting a little more serious. Because now suddenly Haruhi has a mystery to investigate. And there's not going to be an easy explanation like in the murder mystery. She might actually find something.
Well, she has satisfaction in finding something, though? Or is it the thrill of the chase?
True. But it's very dangerous for her to get near anything. So hopefully it's not going to be too bad. But we'll have to find out in later episodes. So that is Haruhi. That is, and this is, again, things get a little complicated because there are episodes of The Melancholy of Haruhi Suzumiya named The Melancholy of Haruhi Suzumiya Part 1, Part 2, Part 3. So this is Part 4 of that series of episodes within the larger storyline.
A subset,
right. So now let's move on to the far more complicated series.
Oh my goodness. Where is my amateur psychiatrist?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. So we're beginning with Episode 6, Mother's Day.
Mother's Day.
Yeah.
What a title. and for something this psycho, so to speak, it is definitely an undertaking.
it certainly is. I should point out, I hope I've been collecting all of them, all of the cards I have of from my notes. And you've
got page after page. Oh my goodness, gosh. I couldn't stop writing. There was so much to it.
We're going to have to show those at the end. Here are the number of pages of notes we have.
Trying to find a blank page was tricky. So tell me about your mother.
Yeah. So this episode, and unusually this episode begins with a quote on screen. The past will often attack the present with the pain of our memories.
This was a good quote to use for this.
Yeah.
We see ghostly images reappear from the past. And it always is a painful experience that's encountered around that time.
Absolutely. And this is a theme that we've seen developed over the course of the series in certain aspects. Stuff with Panaru especially, the girl who had died in the past and the modern girl kind of trying to keep her alive in her memory. And this is the episode where we really build that out. Now, you notice the attribution on this quote is Seiichi Kirima.
Now, Kirima.
Yeah.
Kirima's...
Nagi Kirima.
That must be her dad.
Exactly. Everyone's referring to his book, or we've seen a reference to his
Zaychi's book.
Yes. So this presumably
is from
his
book. She
doesn't
want people to read.
I know. That's strange.
Or at least somebody.
Mm-hmm.
The cheetah girl.
Yeah. And so we begin in a hospital where the younger detective, the younger cop comes out, literally vomiting.
Yeah.
Because he sees Morita's body.
It's a terrible mess.
Yes. Now, again, Morita is the cop. He is the weird cop with the special powers. Hmm. And we come in and we see, and quite interestingly, we see four lab-coated people around him. So this is nothing normal.
Let me confer with my colleague. I've never seen anything like this. Yeah. Have you? Well, no. Get this guy. Maybe he has.
I love how they see, well, there's his eyeballs. There's his, you know, medulla oblongata. There's his liver. It's like, whoa.
This guy's gone to pieces.
Quite literally. And so, so we now know that the cop has been very badly taken care of. And then the cop is out, and we see this interesting moment where he's wandering out, and he sees a ghost of the past. He sees a blood-spattered girl.
And he's concerned for safety. He pulls his weapon.
And
she disappears.
She vanishes, which is quite interesting.
Creepy.
Very creepy. And that's your hint that things are starting to get even particularly weird for people. Now, we do already know that this cop was attacked in some way by Morita.
He seems to be attacked over and over and over again.
Yeah, yeah. Something's going on here. But we do cut back. We cut over to this very interesting moment. We see a Ferris wheel.
Hmm.
And we pan down to someone we already have seen before. And we know her because of her kind of white gown, white dress, and the glowing butterflies. It's Manaka again.
Manaka.
So this is the girl who he seems kind of out of it.
The butterfly girl.
Yeah.
She hits people with those butterflies and they experience some intense stuff.
Yeah, exactly. And so we cut back to 5 years ago, and we're not going to go through this, you know, completely chronologically, but we see that kind of sum up the basics of the storyline.
The murder of Shizui.
Shizue. And so the story takes place by jumping back and forth between 5 years ago and today. This girl, Shizue, was killed by this serial killer who was operating 5 years ago. And we see Nagi Kirima was investigating back then. We also notice something interesting here. Kind of our first indication of something interesting with Nagi Kirima. She looks the same age.
Yeah, she does. I was noticing that. Well, how is this the same girl?
That's an interesting question. But she does definitely look the same age here as in present day.
I hope I can age like that.
Right, totally. And so she questions a friend of the girl who we now see in present day is giving a book to the girl's mother.
A diary.
Now, tell us a bit about these diaries.
Well, that was something interesting. I've seen this in a couple of different anime and stories where people will share a diary.
Mm.
For example, friends will share a diary. They'll write back and forth, or a family will have a family diary. And this was it appeared to be between two friends.
Yeah.
And after Shizue's demise, the friend decides to give the mother the diary so that the mother has something.
Yeah.
Some memory. I guess.
Now, the interesting question here is why now?
Why now? Why?
Yeah. Now? It's been 5 years. Why would she wait so long?
Because the past is coming to haunt her.
Well, that is very true. Now, we find out later, and I'm actually curious how soon the episode hints at this, because I didn't realize until later in the episode what was going on here. We don't see here yet. What's happening is she's moving. The mother is moving somewhere else.
In the process of boxing up and getting ready to go out.
Yep. So that would make sense.
Moving on with her life, so to speak.
Yeah. So this is kind of the friend's last chance to pass this on. And so the mother starts reading this diary. and we find some of this backstory that the father died about 5 years ago, and they were both pretty crushed.
Yes, but the mother repressed apparently a lot of her emotions.
Mm-hmm.
Shizue's absolutely sobbing, and her mother is trying to be strong.
Yeah,
but by repressing it as a coping mechanism, she appears strong outwardly, but she's creating more problems for herself further along. And 1 week after the father's death, I think Shizue actually was able to have some sort of an emotional breakthrough, at least on her part. I don't remember the exact statement that she was able to write in there.
Finally able to
break out of the mourning, I suppose.
And that is really very much what this episode deals with, is this question of, okay, what is strength?
Right? What is strength? Yes.
Is strength sort of powering through and stiff upper lip and not acknowledging those emotions, if you will, or acknowledging them but kind of acting anyway? Or is strength something else?
Processing the emotion and growing from it, or
right? And which is one of the reasons why we see these sequences with I also should point out what how wonderful it is how the mother sells insurance, which is all about the future.
Yeah. In the event something bad should happen, which has happened.
Exactly. Yes. Wonderful bit of writing there. And so she's got this job selling insurance. And so the again, getting back to kind of the plot, is this idea that the mother's trying to be very strong for the daughter. The daughter's trying to be strong too. Mm. And there's this beautiful tragedy in it that they're both being strong for each other, but doing so kind
to the
of
hurt of each other,
exactly,
rather than dealing with it.
Yeah, if they had just sat down and said, I'm hurting so badly from this,
and it becomes this great thing that
really drives them
because
apart.
It could have, it drives them apart.
Yeah,
exactly. We see them distancing each other and not responding in a tender way that that a family should do to heal from after that.
And so the story starts to really do some wonderful stuff, to plant some seeds, which they then reveal is not quite what you think they are.
The Rorschachs. The Rorschach. That's psychological testing.
Right. Which is, again, is kind of your hint that, okay, somebody's being psychoanalyzed.
Somebody has sought professional help.
Right. Exactly. And that's an important hint. That this is not just somebody going to a random therapist. This is somebody who's doing serious things. And then, of course, what is a Rorschach test but a test of being able to see patterns and seeing what's actually going on?
Yeah, what's the deeper
thought process? and indeed, Rorschach tests, I think, are a beautiful symbol for this series in and of itself. You can just look at it and see something obvious. But there's often a lot more going on there below the surface if you look for it. And so we cut back to the doctor in the hospital.
And is that the pregnant?
That's Minaka's mother.
Minaka's mother.
Yeah.
She may be pregnant. But she wants something.
Yeah.
And she gets a shot.
Mm-hmm. Well, you've already seen hints of before. And then we cut over to Shizue, who has these terrible problems, these terrible stomach cramps and things. And the doctor says, and I love the dialogue in here, because the doctor says, and I'm going to forget the exact lines, but what is your abdominal pain like? When does it happen? Wouldn't your hair look better long?
Whoa.
And it just keeps right on going. And then he continues saying things, and he says, okay, now take off your shirt.
And she loses it at that.
She completely loses it at that. She gets highly nauseous. And we've gotten this thing already in the episode that, in fact, one of the first things in the episode is Shizue saying, don't touch me, to her mother.
Yeah.
And then we get this flashback of Shizue and this guy pressing into her.
And almost seemed like a potentially a rape scene.
Yeah, very much
in her memory.
Yeah, very much sexual assault. And so she
her reaction, she can't keep her cookies down.
She she literally
has a very physical reaction just to the memory.
Yeah, yeah, which is pretty bad.
Yeah.
And so you know, we get some back and forth between she's away and the mother.
Manaka's mom.
Yeah, Manaka's mother, thank you. Okay. And whereupon, and then we get some wonderful stuff with the doctor about strength
and PTSD
and PTSD and this whole question of and the doctor says these very interesting things. She says some women are better off weak, of course. Some women prefer to be the weak person who gets pushed around by a guy, and that's just how they'd rather live deep down. Now what's interesting about that is how Shizue responds, which is she's kind of shocked and disagrees. And then the doctor's response is kind of like, oh, okay, you really do have some strength. Cool. So is the, you know, the question is the doctor...
Was that a test? Or was what was that? that left me wondering.
Right. It's very interesting. And we've already seen the doctor say some very odd things.
Yes.
In the past. She has some very specific, strange perspectives on things. But there's also, I mean... Gosh, her expressions throughout the entire thing is very controlling in a weird way.
Does the doctor give her a shot at that point?
It's never stated.
It's never stated, but it's looking.
That is certainly an implication here.
Yeah,
that's what's going on. And there's this wonderful line in here. I think it was at this point where.
Monsters are chasing my mom.
And I not only that, the beginning of the line is monsters are coming.
Monsters are coming.
Which is, boy, is that not the series in and of itself?
That's right, true.
Scene 6,
the present.
Yeah, and so and here, so we get more with that. Diaries in the back. And we get this lovely little flashback to them going to the grave. And Shizue seems pretty normal.
Yeah, she's actually processed some of her stuff. She's wearing something cheerful.
Yeah.
She's dealt with her emotions, and now she's ready to move to a different spot where her mom is still repressing those emotions and trying to appear strong. But the avoidance as a coping mechanism keeps... It's not really courage. It's now a crutch.
It is, exactly. And this is our first hint for the series. We just hit the commercial break, and this is our first hint in the series that things are not all as they seem. You know, we've been given this more or less straightforward narrative up to this point, and now we're discovering that there's a little bit. It's a little bit more complex than that.
Yeah.
And so we get more of this, and then we have this fascinating scene of Shizue's mother. At work, leaving, and she's talking to a coworker. She says, "You should go home."
But it seems like there might be a little bit of romantic interest there.
Yeah.
So he
walks over, puts a hand on her, and what does she say her reaction is?
What was her reaction? It was
all the strength drained from my body.
Yeah.
Strength.
Well, the appearance of her shell of strength is. Yeah. Vaporized, but her loneliness.
And that's the thing, is that you know she has been, she's lost her husband. She's had to get a job, and that's one of the things they explicitly said is that she found a job.
Yeah,
because now she has to support her daughter and save up for college and all these things. And suddenly a man is showing interest in her.
She doesn't have to be the backbone of the necessarily as that she used to be,
and it's almost undoubtedly the first time in years that she's had to even think about that. And I'm sure all of these feelings are racing through her heart about, is this right, is this appropriate, all these things. And a wonderful shot of Shizue running upstairs.
Her ghost
And the mother goes after her, and it's just and that's where we see the empty room with all the boxes.
Initially, I thought, well, that's because she died, but no, it's because she's also packing.
And that was the other hint, is that, you know, 5 years afterwards, you probably wouldn't have a few boxes sitting around. And so now we discover that Shizue's mother was canoodling in a car
with this fella.
With this fella. Probably. Yeah. And Shizue saw it.
Yeah. Shizue dumped a boy. Mm. And then there's some concern about this. So she's opening up to the doctor again. And the doctor mentions that her first impression of sex was the exposure of her mom with somebody other than her dad.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and yeah, and that's when we discover the full sequence before, where this young man is with her, and she says stop, and he says I'm sorry,
I can't help myself.
She shoves him down and runs off.
Yeah.
Nothing happened. Well, I mean, other than a guy getting too
nothing
fresh,
we know of, yeah.
he certainly, you know,
but she's got a little more too close. Affected.
Yeah. So it, you know, it's not that she was assaulted per se in a completely physical sense, but the sense that
her emotional state,
yeah,
having that kind of experience again after the exposure,
mm-hmm. yeah, it was really tough. So we see things are much more complicated than they were. Than we thought they were.
She's not entirely strong. She can't handle that yet.
And that's one of the points, is that, you know, the mother is being strong for the daughter. The daughter can't be that strong.
Yeah.
She's a, you know, she's a young teenager. She just can't process all this on her own. It's also worth pointing out that every time we cut back to a shot of Shizue in the psychiatrist's office, she is curled over on herself.
Yeah.
She just looks miserable.
Closed down.
Totally closed down. And part of that is, you know, apparently stomach cramps, but it's this idea, not just of, you know, this kind of abject misery, but also of being, as you said, closed down, you know, very much curled in on herself.
Yeah.
It's very sad. Whereupon Shizue explains that, you know, I buried myself in my schoolwork and I did everything I was supposed to do. And again, we see the doctor with that very interesting expression on her face.
There was something about Shizue saying the diary and the dandelion.
Yes, so flowers are an important thing about this. And she talks about how she wants to be a dandelion because dandelions are spread by the wind far from their parents. So she can be far away from all of these,
trying to avoid all the stuff that she has to deal with.
Yeah. And I think that's it's a great point about how they're making the point that by not dealing with this stuff, by not being upfront with Shizue, Shizue's response is going as far away from it as possible. You know, if the mother had just been more direct and been more, you know, honest with her daughter, she probably wouldn't be as pulling away as much. Now we have this very interesting animation where the mother is sitting there kind of sobbing to herself. And then a memory butterfly comes along and then breaks. First time we've seen that. And so she looks up and she sees Shizue as a ghost.
Whoa.
And when we've seen ghosts before, but this is the first time that has been directly connected. Another one breaks and we see this very interesting sequence. It's very, very brief, very hard to see, but it looks like Boogiepop is fighting somebody, and it looks like Boogiepop just killed and dissolved the doctor.
Strange.
Very strange. Now, to that point, we also know that there are multiple phantoms running around. So I suspect that is the doctor phantom, but I'm not sure. So now we cut back to Shizue and the mother, and now we get kind of the emotional core of the episode and the reason these characters are together. Because Monaka's mother is very much struggling with this pregnancy. It's obviously very difficult for her. But there is no question in her mind that she wants to have this baby, despite multiple people suggesting that she abort it.
It's funny that she says she's going to name her baby after a flower.
Yeah.
Monaka.
Mm-hmm.
After the dandelion thing and with the
right,
well, all the butterflies.
Right. Well, that's a very interesting idea.
And then previously we saw she had a flower in her mouth at the end. Well,
yeah,
that was different,
but yes, exactly.
Her grandmother, I guess.
Mm-hmm. But yes. And that is precisely kind of why we're seeing some flower imagery here. And even to that point, the Monaka's mother gives her kind of a sex talk and says that, flowers are are
the
two faces of a woman.
The two faces of a woman. The woman is the flower side, and the mother, the second face, is the leaf side.
Mm-hmm.
And she's realized that now, having been pregnant, that there are two faces.
Yeah. It's faces and phases, really, in a sense.
Yeah, really.
And I love that, this whole idea that there is the pretty side of you, and you know, girls want to, or frequently want to, look look attractive, but then also there's the nourishing side.
I found it interesting that she points out here that she has a white hair. She did the same thing with her mother earlier on, and it seemed to almost parallel that. And here's the different phases: your mom,
yes,
or you're beautiful. And pointing out that, hey, you got a gray hair, you're getting old,
right?
you're in mom phase now. You're not in beauty flower phase.
Exactly. And that is exactly that implication, that as you age, your priorities change, and suddenly now you have a responsibility. And it's the lovely depth of this series is that they're saying not only the series is not just saying about how the mother is making her mistakes. They're also pointing out how the daughter is making her mistakes
the same as she turns away when her mother needs support.
And how the daughter doesn't realize the fact that her mother is doing so much for her. And the daughter's kind of all wrapped up in herself.
And it just reinforces the separation.
Yeah, exactly. It's quite sad.
All the different phases of grieving haven't been gone through.
And the wonderful, of course, other implication of that is the fact that flowers leaf and bloom. It's not one or the other. Indeed, the leaves are there much longer than the flowers are. So there's that implication as well, that it's not just saying that your mother is now past it. Your mother has her own story, basically, is what it's saying there. The episode ends with this just heartbreaking moment where another butterfly appears, and there is Shizue in her house, in her kitchen.
Mom.
And she says, "I'm sorry."
Mm.
And she just apologizes. And then she fades away. And that is all the mother is left with, is that memory, that kind of
painful memory.
And again, this is, and the hint here is, with seeing the butterflies, is the fact that, again, those are memories. Those are not wishes.
And unresolved.
So that is what Shizue actually felt at the end.
Yeah.
Shizue actually did feel sorry for her mother, but was never able to tell her.
An unresolved.
Yeah.
Emotion.
And we are left with a flower, not a dandelion.
Yeah.
A different flower, which I think is kind of a lovely metaphor, that Shizue wants to be one thing, but she's actually another. Something actually far more beautiful.
Yeah.
In its own way. So that was Mother's Day. Very emotionally wrenching scene. I remember the first time I watched this episode, and again, to point out, with the name of the episode isn't revealed until the end of the episode.
Mother's Day.
I remember watching this episode and just tears started streaming out of my eyes. And it ends with "Love Thy Mother."
That was tough.
Final shot.
You feel terrible when they can't resolve issues and then somebody dies and this just goes on and
But we are also left with, and interestingly, what is the actual final shot is this amusement park, and Monaka is running around with the butterflies. So we're reminded that Monaka's mother, even though she passed away, has left behind Monaka, and Monaka is still living and enjoying her life. So there is a lovely, hopeful final moment there for that character. So any final thoughts on Mother's Day?
Well, let's see. I'm still kind of wondering about the mystery of those cops.
Yeah.
That's left me wondering.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're about to see a little bit more about what was going on behind the body bag there.
Yeah.
So we'll find out there. In fact, let's go ahead and do that. and switch back over to, and we'll watch episode, talk about episode 7, Until You're in My Arms Again. Now, this has generated a little bit of controversy because the title, and I think we actually get the title here.
You are.
Yes, it's spelled.
Until you are E. You are.
It's spelled Until You Are E in My Arms Again. Now, the director was saying that when he saw that, he initially thought it was a typo. And he went back and like, nope, it should be U-R-E. There's a reason for it.
U-R-E.
Mm-hmm. And so this episode, and again, we're not going to go, you know, shot by shot through this one. But the story is about a sister and a brother. And their relationship is made pretty clear very, very early on. The first moment in the episode, and Boogiepop Phantom is a series which really focuses on that first line of dialogue. You know, that is usually really a good hint, is I'm cold. Somebody is very cold. And we see this little girl who's very cold. And then we get this this great sequence where some bullies are bullying a young man who proceeds to disassemble them.
Useless things.
Yeah.
Useless things are to be destroyed.
Yeah, that is exactly what he says. So we get this interesting element of this. Of this idea. And I should also point out, I mean, this is, again, kind of an indication of Boogiepop's just kind of budget. I'm starting here at 1 minute and 52 seconds, and we get basically the same shot with one intercut until 2:57.
Wow.
It's almost a minute-long shot of just this little...
we filled the show quick, some yeah, more.
Exactly. And there's it's very hard to see what's going on.
Very dark.
And it's this tiny little corner of the shot,
but you can hear.
So why do you think they did this?
You know, it's part of it is emphasizing the dark there.
Yeah.
And to some degree, the dialogue that continues. Then you hear several different voices.
Mm-hmm.
Initially, they sound kind of, you know, it could be not antagonistic, but then it moves into an area where it's obvious these guys are trying to get some money out of this guy, and it's not a friendly situation.
Nope.
It's an antagonistic situation of, you know, the guy's being shaken down, and we see him get upset about it and do something about it.
He sure does. And so one of the guys, and what's also interesting, it's not the same thing to each guy.
No, he breaks them in different ways.
Yeah. The first guy, he leans forward and we see sort of blood and teeth pouring out of his mouth. The other guy, we literally see his hand kind of ripped
up into all the bones.
Yeah, it all kind of spreads out. And then his...
How shall I kill thee? Let me count the ways.
But then his sister intervenes.
Stop, brother.
And this is where, again, this series kind of makes a left turn, where typically this would just be kind of a monster to be fought. Mm-hmm. But then we realize that there's this girl, you know, intervening.
Psycho?
She is... let me just find that here. A little hard for me to remember. Sayako, I think.
Sayako,
something like that.
Sayako.
I think it's Sayaka or Sayako. I just kept referring to
but
the sister and brother.
The sister, yeah.
So they have this very interesting Sayako. There we go.
Sayako.
And so we have not only the until you're not
you are
in, and then we get this interesting little line of text on the screen. There is no wish that doesn't come true. What do they mean by that? Well, we'll find out. So we discover a few things. First off, they have this, the brother is physically abusive to the sister.
Yeah.
She comes in to rescue him and he literally kicks her in the stomach and then shoves her down. It's a very hard shot to watch.
Yeah.
She doesn't complain or anything. She just takes it.
In fact, she defends him after that too.
Mm-hmm. It's almost like she's used to it.
Yeah.
And then she knows he has this power.
Yeah.
And we see this key moment where she walks into his room as he's disassembling it, trying to find the parts that aren't useful.
And she can hear him muttering that I need to find out which parts are useless so I can move them.
And what's also interesting about this is, so A, this is a bit of a shout out to Lane. where there's a sequence where Lane walks into a room where a guy has opened up a computer and something's wrong with it, and he wants to fix it. Yes. And again, Lane's one of those shows that was not hugely popular in terms of making money and lots of people seeing it, but within the anime community, it got a fair amount of attention.
Visually incredible.
Yeah, amazing. So I think, you know, the makers of this would have been aware of Lane, especially for the fact that this sequence is not only referencing it, but also kind of the opposite. Lane walks in and fixes it. Mm-hmm. He is trying to disassemble it.
Yeah.
It's easy to go a little too obvious with this and say, oh, he just wants to find the useless things. you know, when you have a computer, maybe
there's a reason stuff's in.
Yeah, well, but also, you know, especially if you bought one in stock, there may be stuff in there that you don't really use.
Yeah. Yeah,
they have an extra Ethernet card in there. Well, there's one already on the motherboard, whatever.
Like that.
Right. So, I'm assuming the implication here is that this might have been a reasonable, initial.
Kid could be doing that.
Right, but also we see how he's laid everything out in exactly
very methodical.
Place. Very methodical. And two things happen. One, the sister is kind of freaked out. So that's your suggestion that it's not just him being interested in this. He's done this before. He has a perhaps a little OCD or some kind of mentality of this. She's kind of scared for him. But then the room is filled with light.
Right while he's muttering these things.
The incident. The column of light.
Incidents.
And so we see that, and we know now that confers powers on people.
Mm.
And she's
got his powers.
Yep, she's figured this out right away because we cut to this shot of him with this coffee. And now here's the implication for those again watching later. He's sitting there with a cup of coffee. And then she walks in the door and looks at him, and the coffee goes black, and this white stuff comes to the surface.
Mm-hmm.
He's separating the milk from the coffee.
Wow.
So he's able to literally disassemble.
That is wild.
These two things.
I hadn't noticed that before.
And he gets his little smile on his face. and then and the scene where he pulls up a kitten and shows her the kitten. And we don't even see what happens to him, but it's this wonderfully set up thing where, I mean, obviously trying to animate this would have been A, expensive, and B, just not very helpful.
Yeah.
So we pan up just past the kitten, and we see her horrified reaction. We see the blood splatter everywhere. And then we cut back to him holding his hands out with his tracksuit just covered in blood. And then her wonderful reaction that this she literally just turns away.
Look at the maniacal look he's got.
Yeah.
And then he's sickened by it.
Yeah, he's sickened by it. He literally throws up as a result of this. And we saw him throw up earlier.
Yeah.
So we get a bit more of this back and forth. And he's, again, physically abusive to her, which is kind of hard to watch. And she's talking about this. And she wonders, where did this come from? And then we get the whole backstory where he was very creative as a kid. And they were doing this whole thing with the Pied Piper in school,
and he's making his own costume.
He is, which is
very creative,
pretty impressive. Yeah. And I mean, she's in junior high, he's in senior high, presumably going to the academy, Shinyo Academy. So he's 15-ish, and that was what, 5 years earlier. So that he'd be 10.
That's pretty active for a kid that age.
Yeah. So,
very formative age.
Exactly. So the show does something important here, which again, as is typical for the series, it's important to kind of pay attention where she's thinking in school what's going on, and she says, what happened?
Mm.
Like what's going on? What happened to him?
Yeah.
And we hold on that for a while. And every time the series does that, you know you want to pay attention. Because then this classmate comes in and asks if she's read the thing. And we find out that, you know, ironically given or coincidentally given the Haruhi episode, she got a love letter from a boy. And a friend of his is asking what's going on because the guy's too chicken. And she says, I'm sorry. You know,
she turns down Tachibana.
Yeah. So what's the implication there? Wait, what do you think they're getting at with that whole sequence, do you think?
You know, I'm wondering.
I think the point is she's closed down.
Yeah.
She's not letting people in.
What's going on with her?
Yeah. So she's all worried about her brother, but also she's like rejecting other people. Now here we get another great moment where this weird, like random, almost homeless looking guy walks into the police station and starts talking to Marita as though they've known each other all their lives.
Yeah, that was weird. And he rambles on about something about composite humans.
Right. And so Marita asks him who he is, and he replies with what is possibly the best name in the history of the world. I am Spooky Electric.
Spooky Electric. Wow.
Great name. And so they're explaining there are these composite humans around, and they need to kill them all. Well, actually, I take that back. They're saying that there are these new humans around. And they need to kill them all. There's some new breed that needs to be taken care of.
So that was new, not composite, but the new,
right.
New breed.
New yeah. Breed. So the composites are trying to take out this new breed. So they can even have this conversation. The
look at that. That was the photo.
Yeah.
What's her name and her daughter?
Yeah. And so so the cop immediately looks at a photo of Monaka. And then as Spooky Electric is walking off, we see a flash.
Like a gun flash.
Yeah, from the room.
Or something worse.
Who knows?
Maybe it's spooky electricity. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Totally. And so we cut back to Shinyo Academy. And so the sister is waiting for her brother at Shinyo Academy. And they go off and he proceeds to kick her.
Ah.
And Kirima shows up. Naki Kirima.
And she says, hey, you can't treat a girl like that.
Yeah. And he says, well, she's my sister. And she goes, well, that sure makes it fine.
Yeah.
Really?
No. And she's like, no.
Yeah. And so this is interesting line of dialogue. So Nagi, and it's interesting what happens here where he says, let me go. She doesn't let him go. Then he goes, let me go. And Nagi gets this expression on her face. And she pulls her hand away very, very quickly. And you realize it's not just frustration. She suddenly realizes there's more here than just people. We already know by now that Nagi has got some senses. And so the sister intervenes and she says, not here, and runs off.
Yeah, that's weird. Why?
Well, yeah. And so and she goes off and Nagi points out, why did you say not here instead of stop?
They cut to the charm that she had dropped.
Mm-hmm.
And she ran off from Nagi.
And this is very important that Nagi has this charm and she asks what's going on and the sister just takes it and then runs off. This charm. And Nagi is not pleased.
She's not happy. Unhappy Nagi.
Yeah. Nagi knows something more is going on.
But that charm holds a story.
Yes, it does. So now we get to find out what's going on with the charm. The siblings were lost
5 years ago.
Yeah. And we know this because we see a search party out there. They're kind of wandering around. And we see that the sister doesn't quite know what's going on. She's just tired and she's cold.
Mm.
And the brother is keeping up this very brave face and saying, don't worry, very soon. They come to a shed and stop in the shed. And the brother proceeds to carve this little figurine for her.
And carve a luck charm to find home.
Yeah. And gives that to her and then says, I'm going to go off and find help.
As he's carving it, he's telling her a story, calming her down, acting as a caring, loving brother.
Isn't it interesting? I mean, such a complete change in this.
And later on, when she was, she had a thought that her brother was not her real brother when she was confronted by Nagi. And she said, I forgot whether it was internal dialogue or she said it as she's running off. She felt that it wasn't her real.
Yeah, but that he's coming back.
But he's coming back. Yeah,
and here's that implication is that what did her brother do before?
Yeah,
he came back.
Yeah, he was caring. He was loving. He came back.
So she knows he's going.
He's there. He's in there.
He's always there for her. And so that experience with him was what clearly very much kind of. Tied her to him and became and made her just so infatuated with him.
And apparently she's kept the charm ever since that experience.
Totally. And so now we get some more backstory, and this is stuff that we'll actually carry forward to later episodes. Her father is clearly mentally disturbed. And they're playing around with this little model
of an amusement park.
Amusement park, yes. Paisley Park, they call it.
And apparently it's to encourage the dad to feel better.
Mm-hmm. Which is...
After his breakdown, mm-hmm. to lead to his recovery.
Yeah. And get another scene, actually, of her at the hospital saying she's here and she wants to help her her brother. And she says, I'll do anything. I'll do anything for him. Just as long as I can be by his side. And we get a sequence with Manaka. And so Manaka grants them a memory.
Hit them with a butterfly.
Exactly. Give them that butterfly. And so now we see what happened in the past is that their father was designing this amusement park.
Painful memory return.
Oh gosh. And sadly, the brother who is going to be the Pied Piper in this school play asked if his father was going to come to Parents' Day.
Promise.
You promise to be there Parents' Day. And what is Parents' Day?
Parents' Day. That's where the parents come and
right.
Meet the teacher. They meet mm-hmm. each other and then, you know, they take the place of the kids. And yeah. It's very important.
It is very important. It only happens once a year. And what's significant about it is that not only your parents there, all your other friends are there.
With their parents. With
their parents. So if your parent isn't there, everyone knows it.
Oh, why isn't his parents mm-hmm. there? The talk, the wonder
and
that's of the
thing. And they even mention it's going to be this Sunday. Now, Japan has famously long working hours, but Sunday is your day off. A lot of people work Sunday, but you don't, you know, it is a day off. And so he says, sure, yeah, I'll be there.
Yeah.
And of course, he isn't.
Of course, business takes place, and right. The father has to deal with that, and he misses. And we see him, and his son, going on with the play mm-hmm. of the Pied Piper.
And what is that wonderful line in the Pied Piper that the Pied Piper gives to all the parents? Your children will not be coming back.
I'm leading them off. I'm taking your children.
And why?
Because of
you've broken your promise.
Broke your promise. Yeah.
Now, this is working on a couple different levels, because not only is it working as it's kind of his traumatic memory, what's been happening in all of Boogiepop Phantom? The children have been taken away.
Little by little.
Yeah. The children are being taken away.
Childhood loss.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Something is happening here.
The loss of childhood. Level.
And that goes even further. As I mentioned before, Boogiepop Phantom is fundamentally a series about adolescent philosophy. It's about what people believe as they're growing up about how the world works. And this is very much about, you know, your children are being taken away, but also by simply growing up. You know, your children are maturing and growing up, and you better darn well do something about it. You know, time slipping by, you need to take an active part in all this. It's interesting, Boogiepop Phantom is one of the rare anime series where you see a lot of parents. Parents rarely show up in anime, but they are almost constant in Boogiepop Phantom. Yeah. Partly because, you know, that is this message is that parents are important, and that relationship between the two is something that is, and also it's not, as we saw in Mother's Day, it's not just about the parent doing things. The children have to be open to that and have to be willing to take in that perspective of the parents. It's a two-way street. So things don't go too well for the Pied Piper. And so we cut back to the present day. We find out that Marita has gone to the hospital to find Manaka. But we find out Manaka has disappeared.
He shows a photo of...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then we cut to... What's going on here? Oh, yes. So they're in the park with Manaka.
Paisley Park.
Paisley Park. But... Yeah, but they're attacked by Marita the cop. He finds them.
He punches the sister.
She falls to the ground.
And something kind of supernatural takes place.
Boy, he kind of slithers out of his cop uniform and wraps himself around
like
the brother.
Like a snake, like a boa constrictor.
Yeah, well, what is his name? Snake Eyes.
Snake Eyes. Oh, wow. He's squishing the guy.
Squishing the guy, and the guy is freaking out, and the sister... finally is able to, she finally regains consciousness and sees this. And again, interestingly, Snake Eye looks down at her and his eyes widen. And then suddenly he splits apart. He is dismembered.
Wow.
And the brother, and she's suddenly very cold. So what's going on here? And so as we discover later on, is because who should show up but Poom Poom, who seen before, who leads Monaco away.
Kind of like a Pied Piper.
Yeah, kind of like a Pied Piper, indeed. And we'll find out a little later on what's going on with him. But we then discover, or the sister then realizes the, you know, the big twist.
Yeah.
The brother doesn't have any power.
She thinks she had the power to grant wishes.
Yeah.
She was the one who got the power from light, and
mm-hmm.
the brother chooses.
He chooses the target.
The target, but the sister grants the wish.
Yeah. So they discover this, and it's this interesting kind of connected ability.
Yeah.
Where that, and so before, when we've seen the Column of Light event, everyone who's been hit by the Column of Light event has been alone. They were together.
Hmm.
So they got a linked power, if you will. She was able to kind of act as a conduit. She was the kind of the trigger, if you will, while he was the gun sight, so roughly speaking. And so she realized she was the one kind of responsible for all of this. She was the one saying, if you want to be able to disassemble things, I will give you that power. If you want to be able to do all these things, I will give you that power. And so they're, you know, they're finally huddled together in these final moments. Again, very, very dark imagery.
And then as it progresses, we see just as they take solace in each other, just an empty space. And was it the charm?
The charm, there, yeah.
That she never lets go of.
Yeah. Well, and they get up and they walk off. Well, they don't even get up and they walk off. You don't see them.
They've gone somewhere.
And
I presume with Poom Poom.
Possibly. Quite possibly. we'll find out soon. But it's interesting how, and she also says, welcome back, brother.
Yeah. And he seems like he's come back from,
yeah,
from his behavior. It's almost like that recognition of their power and the way that they've been handling things,
yeah,
resolves the issue.
Right. Well, and that's the thing is that, one of the key things about Boogiepop Phantom in terms of the powers is that the powers are simply powers. They grant you abilities. They don't make you smarter. They don't grant you insight about the nature of people.
You mean you're not smarter if you eat bugs off people?
Nope. So they're absolutely able to process and get better and learn things as people. And indeed, at that point, we saw he was already kind of neurotic at the beginning of the episode, even before he had the powers. So it was them able to process that to be able to kind of move on and figure out what's going on. And again, to that point, I mean, he obviously cared about his sister.
Yeah.
And so once he realized that she was doing all this for him, that must have been a very traumatic, very kind of moment for him. And so the episode ends with that surprise. And it's kind of harkens back to the episode of Panaru, where you realize that there are characters who have these relationships to what's going on, but are not even central to the storyline.
By far, this series is the most intensely, densely packed with,
yes,
mystery of any anime I've encountered so far. There's just so much to it.
Yeah, the English director of this said, he has never seen an anime more densely packed than Boogiepop Phantom.
That's a good description.
Yeah, it's just there is so much stuff going on, and unfortunately, a lot of people just kind of either treat it as intentionally dark and confusing, and so just, you know, don't go too deep. Or they look for the most obvious explanations for things, and
watch two or images, three times, and still,
well, yeah, exactly, more. Yeah. Everything here is going somewhere. It is very. It's not just densely packed. It's very deliberately packed. You know, and in fact, I apologize. That was his word. He's never seen a more deliberate anime series than Boogiepop Phantom.
Yeah.
You know, phrases, numbers, imagery, flowers. You know, the dandelion is a specific kind of flower.
The gray, which is the same hair. Thing.
Yeah, the gray hair is a very carefully structured series. So, next episode is called about Her Way of Life. And we will see where that goes.
Next time.
Next time.